fascinating gadgets, gizmos, and gear-based technologies. All right, welcome to the show. You know me, I'm Daniel J. Glenn, the analytical mastermind, and we have, of course, my favorite theoretical physicist, a certified, well, actually, he's certified genius adjacent today, and he is a sci-fi superhero scientist, Dr. Michael Denon. Thanks for being on the
program. Oh, great to be here.
And like all of history's great rocket scientists, ours is a man of mystery. He works in an undisclosed location, can neither confirm nor deny his employer, and is probably paid through some black ops program. Our enigmatic engineer, Ben Siebser, thanks for being on the show.
Happy to be here.
And if we are the three musketeers, then I want to welcome our D'Artagnan. Rounding out this brain trust is Caltech's mistress of microbes, the baroness of bacterial biology, Brittany Needham. And I know you're a doctor, but that would screw up my alliteration, so I'm going to call you now Dr. Brittany Needham. Thanks for being on the program today.
Hi, thanks for being here.
So if you guys had to pick one admirable trait about a spider, what would it be? We're going to go around the table really quickly. And I'm going to start with whom I guess loves spiders the most. And I'm going to go with Brittany. What's your favorite trait of a spider?
Oh, well, it's enviable to everyone, even like technology and the world renowned, the spider web. It's incredible.
What do you like about it?
Well, I don't like when I walk into one, which happens every now and then, especially when you're at the park with your kids.
Sure.
But it's incredible. It's super strong for how thin it is. Spiders can hang from it, and they jump around swinging from ropes like they're in the jungle, like in your...
No, they don't. You
yeah,
can't
they
make
do.
Stuff up.
Spiders jump from
they
one
jump and
place
hang on it like
another.
Tarzan?
Well, they're hanging from their other end than Tarzan.
Okay,
but.
So they're butt grabbing it. They're Tarzan butt grabbing it.
Yeah, many species of spiders jump across huge distances considering their size.
Uh-huh.
To swing their web across to generate their web.
Hmm.
Some of them crawl more than jump, but yeah. And it's sticky. They use it for hunting. It's just incredible. It's incredible. They use it for everything.
So you like the web. That's your favorite part.
Yeah.
Ben, what do you think? What's your favorite part of a trait? You can't say web.
Well, I like the fuzziness, especially in the big spiders that you see in the forests and jungles, like the tarantulas and some of those bird spiders. There's spiders that can catch birds, and that to me is pretty rad. That
Well, given its size that it can catch, I mean, some of them
Well, these are big spiders.
Right. No, I know. Some of them are the size of your hand. Well, it's funny because in Australia, the huntsman spider is a common house spider, and that thing is, A, it's tenacious, B, it's always angry, and C, it's like the size of your fist. I mean, that's a house spider in Australia. That's scary stuff.
Yeah, those Australians are very brave.
They are. They are. They really are. All right, so you like the fur. You like the hairy aspect.
I just like the really gross-looking big spiders. I think they're really cool-looking.
Okay. That's great. So on that note, Denon, what do you like?
Well, I like the fact that they kill and eat the bugs I hate.
That's the reason? Like a bug zapper.
Yeah. Yeah, that's my favorite part. I mean, because I grew up in the Northeast where you have a lot of flying bugs that are just very annoying.
Mm-hmm.
And spiders kill those. And that's just a good thing in my view.
But doesn't everything have a right to live? Like, what's with this? I don't know. This seems...
This is the circle of life, man.
Yes, we have to find enjoyment out of it.
I didn't say I enjoyed it. You asked me what my favorite part was. I don't know if that's the same
it.
Thing.
That's fair. All right, that's fair. Well, I think we all know where this is going. I agree with Brittany. I think that spider webs are incredibly interesting. And that leads us into what we're talking about today, which is, of course, how can Spider-Man create web fluid and then shoot it out, mimicking the spider that bit him. And I think first of all, Spider-Man is my favorite superhero. Second of all, I love the idea that this has both biological and technological aspects to it. So why don't we, Brittany, you're a spider web fan. Tell me about spider webs.
Well, in the spider body, there's always it's always being regenerated, right? The spider's always producing more of this this fluid that's kind of a combination of a fiber and a gluey, sticky substance. And that would run in, that'd be a problem for Spider-Man. Because if you're in, if you have it in a canister or something, you need to always have it being regenerated. So I think that's interesting about spiders. They can just always have it ready to go. I'm sure there are limits to that, depending on the spider. But
well, when the spider poops it out, I guess for lack of a better term, it's actually dehydrating the protein, right? So there's like a chemical react, physiological reaction going on before it's actually produced in the world, right?
You mean by the spider itself?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so.
So that's, I mean, that may cause a problem because there's two real considerations here. There's one, the webbing itself, which to me is the most interesting aspect. And two is how can we shoot it out? And I know that spiders don't necessarily shoot it out, or do they? Can they shoot it like Spider-Man?
There might be species that do that, but I don't know of any that do.
Okay. Well, you're not an entomologist, so I won't put you to the test on that. But, I mean, that to me, that's the most interesting aspect. In spider webbing, it has some pretty interesting properties. I mean, strength-wise.
Sure, yeah. It's kind of a solid and a liquid a little bit at the same time. It can be, can hold a structure, but then if you touch it, it stretches. But then if you let go, if you're not too stuck to it, it goes right back to its original structure. It doesn't sag and just become really stretched out. It just goes right back, bounces right back.
Well, and I think the reason why most people don't really love this stuff the way, obviously it's annoying if you walk into it, but it's on such a micro level. So everything you're talking about is on a very small level because it has incredible properties. So Denon, I think the key to this right now is how can we kind of scale up the important and useful properties of spider silk?
So the key idea in spider silk is it's not a single material. You're going to hate me for this, Dan. Guess what I'm going to make a connection to?
You're going with foam, I assume.
I will. I'll get there in a moment, right?
I got a foam thing for you too. Don't worry.
So but the key piece of spider silk is at the molecular level, it's a composite material, which is the simpler way of saying it's composed of more than one thing. And it's got proteins that are both very stretchy and proteins that are both very rigid. So it becomes very elastic and very strong. Most materials historically that we make are either elastic or very strong. It's hard to get those two properties together. So it's actually been a long-term dream of material scientists to recreate what spider silk does. And it's only been very recent that we've been able to do that in the lab in various ways. And so that's one of the incredible features, and it shows a common theme in material science is to look to nature to, you know, copy what nature figured out in our own, you know, processing of materials. So that's at the microscale. Now, once you understand the molecular sort of properties of it, you can start asking questions of, can I do this at a larger or higher scale? But with spider silk, once you figure out how to make spider silk, you know, you just make thicker strands and you get a lot of the properties. And so I'm like you, Dan, Spider-Man's clearly the best superhero. Mm-hmm. And what's fascinating to me is it's not unreasonable. You know, you watch and you see how thick the strands are that he uses. And they're not that, you know, far off or unreasonable from a physics point of view. It's so, not a horrible thing.
So a spider, like when you watch a Spider-Man movie or whatever, the thickness of that web is about what it would take for him to swing around on.
Yeah, you know, close enough.
Okay.
I mean, it's not like you would need strands, you know, meters thick. And they certainly are thicker than the ones you see spiders use. So, you know, maybe it needs to be three times thicker than they're showing. But, you know, that's not such a horrible thing you could imagine doing it. I think, as Brittany said, the biggest problem for Spider-Man is generating, storing the precursor material.
Got it. Right.
That's the physics problem.
Okay. Well, I mean, in your point of incorporating biology, like this is, we've been doing this. Damascus steel is one of the strongest steels that we've ever encountered. And actually how it was made, this is in the 18th century, how it was made is kind of lost to time. But they do know that it contained carbon nanotubes from organic material that they put in.
Right. So that's, I think, you know, that's an example of where we as humans have done this composite material, but by accident. Uh-huh. And that's the difference. What I was sort of pointing out is
penicillin, right?
Yeah. Yeah. And as you said, we're not. We can now recreate Damascus steel, because we've been able to analyze it well enough. Yeah. I mean, it may not be exactly what the Damascus steel was, but it's got the same flavor. It's got the same properties. We may not.
It'll taste the same? So they, yes, they exactly. nailed that. They it's nailed
the,
that.
We've nailed the flavor.
Okay, good.
We may not be making it the exact same way they did,
yeah.
But we're getting the major properties that you want.
Okay.
Right? But it's a similar problem that we had, you know, with spider silk. For a long time, you didn't have the ability to look at the microstructure, so it wasn't clear what the properties was. It's only recently we've discovered the carbon nanotubes in the mm-hmm. Damascus steel. And I'm glad you mentioned carbon nanotubes.
Why is that?
Because really, when you look at materials, strength and stretchiness, they're kind of that next generation after spider silk.
Mm.
Yeah, they're going to take us a whole new level if we can figure out how to make them big enough, or if, like with Damascus steel, just having them incorporated in the material helps enough. So that's kind of where we're going with carbon nanotubes. They're that next generation after spider silk.
Got it. And Ben, what about creating this from an engineering standpoint? Is this possible?
Oh, yeah, for sure. So we make artificial spider silk, and but it's not actually artificial, because the proteins in the spider silk are actually pretty complex, and it would be very difficult to synthesize those non-organically. So what we actually do is we genetically engineer creatures to make the spider silk for us. And there's kind of two ways they do that. One is kind of the less interesting way, which is you modify E. coli and other bacteria, and you put the genes for making the spider silk in them, and then they, you know, just kind of, they eject spider silk proteins as one of their waste products, and you can filter that and make spider fluid yourself. The other way is, which is the more common way, is you actually splice that gene into the milk genes of goats. And so the goats end up with their milk filled with spider silk protein. And similar to that, you milk the goat, and then in that milk is the spider protein, and you can filter it out, and then you can start making spider silk. We've not actually made spider silk that's as strong as real spider silk yet. It's, I think, like a tenth as strong, but you know, we'll get there. And even a tenth as strong spider silk is still really, really great stuff. So once you have that spider fluid, all you do is the spider fluid is very similar to the standard polymer fluids that we use to make things like nylon or Kevlar or any of those. So you just basically squeeze it through a mechanical aperture.
Like a Play-Doh factory.
Yeah, like exactly. Just like the Play-Doh Fun Factory, but a little more technical. And
oh, there's more bells and whistles on the
yeah, there, you usually have to create microstructures to get the polymers to line up properly so that you actually create, maybe not so much microstructures, but you have to put some serious engineering into it to mm-hmm. actually get it to line up in a way that creates a strong long-chain polymer. But once you squeeze it through that orifice, you end up with strand of spider silk that's pretty strong, just like we make nylon or Kevlar. And that's the same way a spider's spinnerets work, is they have the fluid in their body in a sac, and they basically just squeeze it out, and it goes through this, you know, in this case an organic hole in the spider's body, and it creates spider silk because it dries it out a little bit, and the shape of that orifice causes it to, you know, solidify into that strand.
And that shape, like a Play-Doh Fun Factory.
Exactly.
Like if it was a star-shaped, it would be like a star-shaped strand of spider silk.
Maybe.
Now here's a question. So now, obviously, we can genetically modify stuff.
Yes.
Right? Wouldn't it be easier just to genetically modify a spider to be 80 feet tall, and then we'll just take out full-size spider strand out of it? Besides, obviously, the 50s-style like horror movie.
Brittany
aspect.
May have some comments on this, but generally, insects can't get that big. Exoskeleton creatures kind of collapse under their own weight once they get to a certain size, just because they don't have properties they don't have organs that are really designed to scale up like that. Mm. So it'd be pretty difficult to do that sort of thing.
Is that true, Brittany?
Well, let's say that we can. Let's say we can make an 80.
Thank you, Brittany. Let's say that we can. Thank you.
Let's say that spider exists, and then we're just harvesting this rope, the webbing, then we have it already polymerized, already, you know, out in rope form. When I think before we're imagining that these proteins are not attached to each other, it's like this soup of web proteins.
Or milk, or goat milk of
goat milk of proteins, and it's getting polymerized, like kind of put together as a chain of proteins as you shoot it out. And so if you have it already as a rope, that might give you, does that limit your potential with physics? Because then you're just carrying around all this rope, right? Well, maybe that makes it easier because you don't have to polymerize it in real time as fast as it shoots out of the shooter.
Oh, I see what you mean. Well, it also is significantly less malleable. Like, it's one form, right? Like, if you have it in the soup, you can pull it out and you can make it as long as you want, as thick as you want.
Sure.
Like, it's not as adjustable.
And also, it's not going to be as as space efficient. So
that's fair.
Like, our intestines are crumbled up and smushed together into our bodies. Or DNA in a cell, if you spread it out, you know, people do those calculations of how long your DNA would be if you put it end to end. So these polymers, these chain links, would be the same way. If it's already in rope form, it's going to be a lot harder to fit it into the shooter than if you can compact these little proteins and figure out a way that they're not connected to each other yet. You can just smash them all in.
No, that's a very excellent point. Now, I will say that there are several companies doing this and all kind of taking different approaches to it. You know, like Ben said, there are people using real spider silk. They're splicing it into E. coli, which I know that's a bacteria always the way to go. I know that's your love, Brittany. It seems like that seems, I don't know. It when it comes out, how do you, it just seems like, how do you get it out? It's at a micro level, right? Like, it's just one molecule of spider silk, wouldn't it be? Or
so you could. Well, and if you figure out all the if you figure out the different proteins you want to be part of this spider silk, you could engineer the E. coli to be making both parts, as long as you can figure out a way that the proteins don't automatically attach to each other when they first come out. But you can engineer the E. coli to spit it out of their cells, and then you just, you know, spin down the bacteria in a centrifuge really fast, and then this liquid that's left is going to have the proteins. And that this happens all the time in every company that's producing drugs and proteins, things like that. You can get pretty high levels of things out of bacteria. They're mass producers.
Well, I mean, it just seems like you need a lot of them. But I guess.
But Dan, remember, they're small.
No, I know. I'm aware of their size.
It's not like the goats, you know. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Although it'd be cool if we had a bacteria that was the size of a goat. But anyway, so what else is kind of cool about doing this from a natural standpoint is they did this experiment where spiders produced spider silk like they want to do, and they sprayed them with a graphite graphene carbon nanotube kind of solution. These spiders incorporated it into their body. I don't know how it didn't kill them or turn them into like a Han Solo type thing, like frozen in carbonite. I don't understand that, but it didn't. But they incorporated it in, and then they created spider webs that actually had the carbon nanotubes, which made them, I think, like 30 to 40% stronger. So there is the natural way to do this is really cool. There's companies that are using, like, there's a company that it's called AM Silk, and they produced an Adidas shoe. Arachnotech is a place at Utah State. I think it's Utah State. Yeah, Utah State University, and they're using the goat thing. So we have ways to produce this. Now, the real key is it possible to take this and put it at a level? I think when you're making the spider fluid, what question did we originally ask? Well, the question is, how do we make spider fluid that Peter Parker, or anyone for that matter, can keep on him in a portable form that will then come out in the spider web? Can we do that? And I think foam's the answer, Dan. I think you're going with this, but how can we do that process?
Well, so I think there's two questions. And here's the problem for the Spider-Man fans out there. You know, and the physicist in me loves the fact that he originally built his web shooters. Okay. And the advantage of building them is designing. So as was mentioned earlier by Ben, I think one of the challenges is what you get out depends a lot on effectively your spinnerets, the nozzle, the pressure design, how you shoot it. And you can imagine a fair amount of flexibility because spiders already actually do make different types of silk strands. And there are spiders that shoot out blobs of silk versus strands of silk. So, you know, Spider-Man does a whole bunch of different stuff with his web. And to do that, you would probably want a mechanical shooter that the nozzles, the spinnerets, those things, you know, changed as you needed things. And in today's miniaturizing of technology and ability to do that, you'd have some maybe some computer chips in there to help you pick it. You could rapidly pick between different types of webs. The problem with the handmade one is even if you go with a foam-like concept, right, where you're storing material in a way so that you have to store less of it per volume than you're going to use when you get out because you're going to have air and other things coming in to make the volume greater, you're going to be fundamentally limited with what you can carry. And it's always going to cause a problem. Now, the flip side is the brief moment in time for three movies where Spider-Man's web shooters were built into...
50 years of comics, by the way.
No, where his...
that's Ultimate Spider-Man. It's 100 comics, but I know what you mean. Yeah.
Okay, where very few of the time is it built into him genetically.
Like biologically, right?
Now, in that case, I think the advantage is you're like the spider. You're generating it as you need it. And the limit is basically how much food and how much material you have, how much of your body you're going to use up at any given time. Mm-hmm. You have your whole body in which to store the fluid and draw it from.
Ish.
Basically, right. Ish. You have the other challenge, though, that your spinnerets are going to be kind of hardwired. So I was thinking the cool thing to do is genetically make you the source, like the goat. You become the source of the material in the liquid, but you scientifically engineer the shooter. So the liquid feeds from your body into the shooter, and then the shooter is engineered to make the different types of webs. So you become the reservoir.
So you're like one big silk-producing gland.
So you are one big silk-producing gland.
But then you don't have any other properties like climbing walls.
You don't have to fill your whole body with the silk-producing gland. But you get a greater volume than carrying around a big, heavy, chunky... cylinder to carry your silk in.
Now, you do realize he didn't choose how he was genetically modified. That was all left to fate, right?
Right. But now you, as the scientist, on the outside...
Oh, replicating it.
Could you're genetically modified to make the silk. Now you connect to that spinneret and add, attachments.
Sure.
Nozzle attachments. It's kind of like, my cake decorating set.
Sure. No, that's a great observation. But how do we do this in real life is what I'm saying.
Well, so that's, I told you how you do it in real life.
Genetically modify a human?
Well, actually, ironically, and then I'll let the other speak, this combination, it's not insane. I mean, we've already talked about the cow, the goat we've genetically modified. No, it is not insane to modify a human to... like we modify the goat to produce the key biological elements of the silk. It's the challenge is always once you have the elements, then forming the actual silk rod. And that's why I propose a combination bio and technological solution. The genetic modification is for producing the proteins you need, and then the technology is for turning those into the silk. That's all I'm saying.
All right, so I don't know why I'm gonna do this, but I'm gonna walk down this road with you. Brittany, is it possible to genetically modify a human to be a spider silk producing reservoir?
Absolutely. We make all sorts of fluids and proteins. That's like what we do. Most of them are for other purposes than swinging from buildings.
Easy on a kid's show. But spider silk could be in there.
Sure, yeah. Getting it to, so if you want it to come out of your wrists, it probably need to be produced like a gland in some way. Like the goat, it's already producing milk, and then it was easy to engineer that. So
right. Oh, so you have to engineer it into like an existing...
I think so. Engineering a whole new system that could produce a liquid that then is going to be excreted, that's going to be hard. But...
from a new... you couldn't... so you're saying... I see what you're saying. So you couldn't like create a new orifice that would specifically shoot out. It would have to come out of... you'd have to pee it out or poop it out, basically.
If you're going to do it genetically, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, of course, there's a surgical implantation you could imagine doing to be able to get it, string a tube through your arm or something. but that's going to be farther away from being a safe procedure that could happen.
See, combining technology and biology. That's all I'm saying, Dan.
Yeah, but the gene therapy options, I mean... not talking ethically and being able to actually legally do this.
Throw that out the window.
Yeah,
we don't need any of that here.
Sure, yeah. If that's doable. That's doable.
Wow.
I think, though, Spider-Man's pretty slender.
Yeah.
And I really think he'd have, like, a gut. Like, think of a spider's abdomen.
Yeah.
I mean, the whole spider's abdomen is not filled with fluid for the web, but...
sure.
Yeah. Spider-Man's going to have a bit of a belly now.
Sure. He'll have a pear-shaped with the big butt. of spider fluid. all right, so is this what we're going with? Is this what you guys want to?
Well, there's one other thing. So
thank you, Ben.
I was at the spider pavilion at the Natural History Museum recently, one thing I learned is that the spiders actually eat their own silk and recycle it. So one thing is Spider-Man needs to probably also be clean up after himself and eating the ropes as he swings through.
I don't think that's where Dan wanted you to go.
Nope. I thought you were going to save me, Ben. Now I'm threatening to boot you off.
But that's a good way to deal with the issue of how do you have so much fluid is you can constantly recycle this. And that's what spiders actually do is they eat their own silk.
And then reuse it.
And then reconstitute it back into fluid and make it again.
Got it.
Actually, I never thought of that. That's kind of a clever idea. We always see Spider-Man leaving his webs behind.
Yeah.
But you could probably imagine designing a shooter that you actually made it look more like, you know, a grappling hook or a replying thing where you pulled the rope back in. Mm-hmm. That would be interesting.
Pull it back into your body. You're going.
I'm talking the technological one now. Like, how do you keep enough silk around?
Oh, right? We're going back to a plausible explanation. Okay, so, so I see that. Okay, that makes sense. So you would reuse the silk instead of having it inside of like a little cartridge that it would reuse like a Batman gun, kind of.
Yeah.
Okay. And you have like an enzyme to degrade it back into its single protein form, so you can just reshoot it out again too.
Yeah.
Oh wow. Okay. Well, I think we've solved that. This isn't the solve I was looking for, but that's why I've assembled you guys. So the one thing I do want to mention before we close this out is there's this really cool product. It's called Fabric in a Can, which is basically like an aerosol can that you can spray cotton shirts on people. If you really want that skin tight look, I guess. But I just thought that the technology was interesting because it's basically taking like a fiber and it's spraying it out in an aerosol form. Which is similar. You obviously need more force behind this stuff, but we've abandoned that.
I'm glad you brought that up because, like I said, the shooting mechanism is going to, I think, have to be technological. Uh-huh. And you are right that we are really making advances in how to spray out various interesting composite materials as fibers to form the silk. Because, you know, everyone had mentioned earlier, from a recreating spider silk form, we very much got like the goats and the bacteria first to make the components.
Yeah.
It was much longer and harder for us to make the equivalent of the spinnerets. The technology to turn the soup into silk strands was always the key. And that's why I said, if it's going to be either way you go, whether you're putting the stuff, storing it in a canister or generating it in your body, mm-hmm. I think the shooter has to be technology.
Okay. Yeah.
No matter what.
Okay, that's fair.
The pressures involved in actually shooting a rope aren't too high. They're not crazy. Like with about 300 PSI, you can shoot something about 60 feet. Uh-huh. You probably want a blob at the end, but you're going to need that blob at the end anyway to stick. So that works out.
Blob in the end is key, by the way. You're kind of passing over it, but a blob at the end is like key to this whole thing.
Right. Yeah. That'll help a lot with the aim and the it carrying through. But the little CO2 cartridges you can buy in a store, those have like 1,000 PSI in them. So it's not crazy to have...
Like a pellet gun.
Yeah. So it's not crazy to have small, very high pressures and very small packages in your web shooter. Mm-hmm. So it's a very reasonable... That part of it's actually pretty reasonable, the projecting it, if you have something heavy at the end to carry
kind of guide it.
Carry it and pull the rope along.
Okay, so we've got a couple different solves here. Didn't expect the genetically modifying a human being to produce spider silk exclusively and then attaching a technological apparatus on it to shoot it out. But that's where we ended up. So if you're listening to this and you are a person who genetically modifies humans for spider silk, contact us at the show or comment on one of our feeds. So, Denon, how can people get in touch with you?
So you can find me at Denon Michael. That's on Twitter or on Facebook at Prof, P-R-O-F, Denon Michael.
Ben, how can I get in touch with you?
You can find me on Instagram and Twitter at B-Siepser. That's B-S-I-E-P-S-E-R.
Brittany, how about you?
Instagram is Biddy383 or email bneedham at caltech.edu.
Wait, what's the Instagram? Biddy, itty, bitty?
Biddy383, B-I-T-T-Y, 383. I've had it since, a long time.
The Instagram feed?
Biddy.
Well, that's just been, email and whatever. I've had it so long that it's just stuck.
Okay, no, that's fair. I just want to make sure I wrote it down correctly. There wasn't any judgment in my voice. Uh-huh. Sure.
BITTY
383.
It's okay, I've had plenty of judgment.
No, it's fair. And that's at Instagram.
Yeah.
And I am on Instagram at the Daniel J. Glenn. I'm on Facebook at Analytical Mastermind. And I am on Twitter at Daniel J. Glenn. Guys, I think we really solved this. We went with the easiest Occam's razor explanation. So thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for listening. Have a good night.